Without objection, we will move this item to the suspense file.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. We have Senator McGuire, then we have Senator Pan, and then Senator Morrell. Senator McGuire, please come forward. Senator McGuire, you have one item on candidate for suspense, SB 297.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair.
Please proceed.
Thank you, sir. Hope you had a good weekend, and good morning, members. Senate Bill 297. Nearly one quarter of California's residents live at or below the poverty threshold, the highest rate in the country. At the height of the recession, more than 4 in 10 California adults, roughly 3.8 million folks, suffered from food insecurity, and more than one-third of them said that they had to cut back on food because they didn't have enough to eat. Today, about 4 million people receive food benefits through the CalFresh program, with an average benefit of about $5.10 per day. According to Moody's Analytics, CalFresh benefits have the highest economic multiplier effect out of all other government programs or fiscal policy tools that stimulate California's economy. It's estimated that a $1 increase in food stamp payments boosts the local economy by $1.73. Yet California has historically had an exceptionally low rate of participation, and it has been ranked last or near last in the country for years and has been criticized by many. The state and legislature have made major advancements in the last several years, and SB 297 builds on that progress in three critical ways. One, it requires the Department of Social Services to develop an electronic data verification process so counties can, if they choose, access electronic data information from existing sources to verify application information quickly. It will also cut out extra steps for clients and workers. SB 297 requires that the state do this in time to qualify for federal 90-10 matching funds attached to the Affordable Care Act. Two, while state law directs counties to conduct eligibility interviews by telephone, most counties still have to print out an interview and then mail back to the client for signature and then ask the client to mail it back to them. A very clunky process and, quite frankly, a barrier. Only 7 counties in the state currently are storing telephonic signatures so they can avoid the snail mail process. SB 297 does two things to fix this problem. One, it requires the department to issue guidance to the counties to clarify how to store signatures electronically or telephonically, and it directs the state to come up with data storage within the existing statewide automated welfare system for counties to use if they don't have a way to do it themselves. Finally, this bill codifies existing practice about when a county should conduct a face-to-face interview rather than a telephone or electronic interview. Finally, Mr. Chair, just related to the analysis, do really appreciate the thorough staff analysis, and it did note that this bill could have unknown and potentially major costs for the technology upgrades. We have been working closely with the Department of Social Services. In fact, our next meeting is this afternoon with the department, along with the County Welfare Directors Association, and we believe that many of the elements exist or can simply be added to the existing automated systems that are in place now. And again, our next meeting is this afternoon, and we are really looking forward to continuing to work with your staff and yourself to identify new ways to do these upgrades efficiently and, of course, without major technology costs. Sir, today we have Kevin Aslayan. I just butchered his last name, Coalition of California Welfare Rights Organizations, and we're grateful that Kevin is here today.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
And also Michael Harold is right next to me from Western Center, but I'll be Kevin Aslayan, Coalition of California Welfare Rights Organizations. And this bill basically brings us into the 21st century. And there's a real problem with a lot of working people. Working people get CalFresh and CalWORKs benefits. Often they have to take a day off and maybe even lose their jobs just to go through the process. And if you could do this telephonically and use the 21st century tools, you would also achieve a lot of efficiencies. So we support this bill.
Thank you. Additional witness support.
Mike Carroll with the Western Center on Law and Poverty. We too stand in support for this bill, and we concur with Mr. Aslanian's comments about the merits of the bill. And we also would note that we believe that this will have real benefits for people in rural parts of California who often have to travel long distances to welfare offices to do some of the reporting that would be eliminated under this bill, because we could use more modern means to effectuate that. Thank you. We support it.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support? Witnesses in opposition? Finance?
No file.
No file. Comments or questions from committee? Seeing none, without objection, we'll move this item to suspense. Look forward to working with you on this.
Okay. Thank you so much, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Next, we have Senator Pan. Senator Pan, you have two items, SB 373 and SB 435. My understanding is you're waiving presentation on SB 435, correct?
Correct, yes.
Then members will hear SB 373. Go ahead.
All right, thank you, Chair and members. SB 373 will help maintain the ratio of full-time to part-time faculty at our community colleges and improve the educational outcomes for all of our students, particularly students from low socioeconomic and unrepresented communities. SB 373 was purposefully written so that there would be no cost to either a local district or the state. SB 373 merely requires the state to use resources that they already have available to hire new faculty. These be spent on hiring full-time rather than part-time faculty. This bill does not require districts to spend any more money than funds they have already allocated in their approved budget plans. In fact, SB 373 would actually save districts money in the long run by providing a more stable workforce. The turnover rate for part-time faculty is actually very high, with as much as 25% of the part-time workforce leave during any given school year. By increasing the ratio of full-time to part-time faculty, this turnover rate will be reduced, resulting in lower overhead costs to districts to hire and process new employees. Finally, there are no new report costs generated by SB 373 because the reporting requirements are already taken from reports that the district already is required to submit on an annual basis. As the analysis correctly states, these costs are absorbable. The legislature has long recognized that full-time faculty are critical to student outcomes because full-time faculty increase student engagement and significantly improve educational outcomes for all students. I look forward to working together to help SB 373 move forward, and thank you so much for your time and consideration. I have one witness.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Chair, members, Megan Brightwell on behalf of the California Federation of Teachers. Again, just to echo the Senator's comments, we don't believe that this bill will impose a state reimbursable mandate. We believe that this is just setting, asking the districts to prioritize how they spend the money they already have and not asking districts to spend resources that they don't have in their budgets. We would ask for your support when this at the appropriate time. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support, please come forward. Witnesses in opposition. I was about just to get to that. Go ahead.
Thank you, Chair and members. Mark McDonald, McCallum Group, on behalf of a number of local community college districts, Yuba, Kern, Los Rios, Peralta, San Diego, Pasadena, and South Orange County community college districts. We're in opposition for cost reasons. We believe the analysis does a good job of laying out what the cost is for our districts to hire full-time faculty. That is the primary reason we don't hire full-time faculty, is the cost. When the 75-25 law was passed, it was indicated that we would get funding to hire those full-time faculty. That happened for 2 years and hasn't subsequently happened. Additionally, this would put cost pressures on our local district to move the funding that we could use to hire counselors and tutors and other members that provide student success support to our students. That's why we're in opposition. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in opposition of the measure. Finance.
No file.
Comments or questions from committee members? Seeing none, without objection, we'll move this item to suspense and look forward to working with you on this item.
Thank you.
Any other? There's more. See that there's no other senators here. Can we have Senator Bell, would you like to present your item?
Sure.
Members, we're moving to Senator Bell, and that is item. That's item SB 490 as a due pass recommendation, and you are waiving presentation on SB 640, correct? Please proceed, Senator Bell.
Thank you. Chair and members, SB 490 promotes audit uniformity for vendors working with the developmentally disabled. Now, specifically, this bill adjusts the financial thresholds for fiscal audits and reviews, clarifies that only monies paid by the regional centers can be counted toward the threshold, making it consistent with standard auditing practices for federal monies. And thirdly, it allows vendors whose audits demonstrate they are in compliance to get an audit waiver for 2 years. In 2011, the Developmental Services Trailer Bill, SB 774, which I didn't vote for, just say that, included provisions intended to save over $20 million annually through increased accountability by requiring these audits. To date, none of the audits have resulted in any savings. So this cost money because the $20 million wasn't realized. With an average cost of $10,000 per audit, full compliance is estimated to cost the vendors providing services for the developmentally disabled $57 million. The money for these audits was not included in the budget, so the cost of the audits would absorb by reducing service to people that have developmental disabilities. The adjustments in SB 490 create uniformity with state requirements for the nonprofits and reduce the financial burden for the vendors with clean audits. We have bipartisan support, and this bill is joint authored by Senator Huff. Urge support.
Witnesses in support of the measure.
Boyd Bradshaw, Res Coalition, strong support.
Thank you.
Care provider in strong support of this bill.
Diana Hernandez, also care provider, strong support.
Additional witnesses in support of the measure.
Mr. Chairman, members, Dwight Hansen on behalf of the Alliance supporting people with intellectual and developmental disabilities in strong support.
Thank you. Witnesses in opposition of the measure. Finance.
No file.
Comments or questions from committee? The bill is moved by Senator Hill. Secretary, please call the roll.
The motion is do pass to the Senate floor. Lara?
Aye.
Lara, aye. Bates?
Aye.
Bates, aye. Bell?
Aye.
Bell, aye. Hill?
Aye.
Hill, aye. Leyva?
Aye.
Leyva, aye. Mendoza? Nielsen?
Aye.
Nielsen, aye.
We'll hold that roll open to allow Senator Mendoza to come back. Senator Leyva, I understand you're presenting for Senator Pavley? Perfect. That is members SB 739 by Senator Pavley will be presented by Senator Leyva. And you also have your SB 592, which is a candidate for suspense. You're going to present on that?
Yes.
Let's start with Senator Pavley's bill, please.
You got it. Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and committee members. First, Senator Pavley would like to express her appreciation for allowing me to present this bill, and I'm grateful to be here to do it for her today. She will accept the committee's recommendation to remove the study provision as the author's amendment, and this will relieve any fiscal impact that would have been caused. SB 739 would prohibit school districts in negative certification from authorizing charter schools that are intended to be located outside of their geographical boundaries. There are no fiscal implications for this local policy change. Some school districts have authorized out-of-district charters in order to generate revenues through oversight fees. Not only does this take precious limited resources from our students, but it also undermines accountability to the local community and parents. The governor is developing recommendations on how to address this problem as well. The recommendations will be forthcoming. I have Mark Winger with me here, former superintendent of New Hall School District, to testify in support and answer any questions.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Thank you, Mr. Lauer, and members of the committee for an opportunity to comment on SB 739. I am Mark Winger, former superintendent of New Hall School District. I'm representing the five school districts of the Santa Clarita Valley, 75,000 students who are sponsors of this bill. The bill has been amended to remove the study, so there's no cost to CDE. But I do want to comment on the negative certified district issues. Forbidding them from approving out-of-district charters will have a significant fiscal aspect on those districts like mine who have been subject to these out-of-district charters, including our loss of ADA, and significant legal fees we've expended to stop what the courts have now said are illegal placements. Ultimately, this is a cost avoidance for the state. You keep the focus on the structural problems in the budgets of the negative districts rather than allowing an illegal revenue generation scheme to continue. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional witnesses and support.
Mr. Chair and members, Aaron Evans-Budom on behalf of the Association of California School Administrators, as well as the School Employers Association of California, also in support. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support on this item? Witnesses in opposition? Seeing none, finance.
I don't have a file.
Comments or questions from the committee? This is a do-pass recommendation, members. There's a motion by Senator Hill. Secretary, please call the roll.
The motion is do pass as amended to the Senate floor. Lara?
Aye.
Lara, aye. Bates? Bell?
Aye.
Bell, aye. Hill?
Aye.
Hill, aye. Leyva?
Aye.
Leyva, aye. Mendoza? Nielsen?
No.
Nielsen, no.
We will hold the roll open to allow our absent members to add on. Senator Leyva, now we will move to your bill, SB 592. Please proceed.
Thank you. Good afternoon again, Mr. Chair and members. I was excited to present Senator Pavley's bill, but I'm even more excited to present this bill. I first would like to thank the committee staff for their hard work on this bill and, of course, the committee members for considering the importance of this bill. This bill will help protect California's young people that are truly the future of our state. The hope of this bill is it will help break the cycle of violence and abuse in young people. Many young people do not have a good example at home of what a healthy relationship looks like. This bill, Senate Bill 592, would amend the education code to require that schools serving 6th to 12th grade update their policies to include within their school safety plans guidance on how to prevent, detect, intervene, and respond to incidents of adolescent relationship abuse, as well as to promote education on healthy relationships. Adolescent relationship abuse is a very serious problem in schools throughout our state, and its negative impacts not only directly affect our school-aged children, but also their families, schools, and communities. Studies show that victims of dating violence or sexual coercion are 3 times more likely to receive D's and F's than to receive A's. According to the U.S. Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, teens who are victims are more likely to be depressed and do poorly in school. They may engage in unhealthy behaviors like using drugs and alcohol and are more likely to have eating disorders. Some teens even contemplate suicide. As compelling as these facts and figures clearly are, we all know that abuse is wrong and we must do everything in our power to prevent and respond to it in our schools, where our kids spend the better part of their lives on their way to becoming adults. Clearly, the stated cost of this bill pales in comparison to the great benefit it will have for thousands upon thousands of students that it will help to protect, educate, and empower throughout the Golden State. Here with me today in support of the bill is Crystal Guerrero with the Women's Foundation of California Policy Institute and Krista Nemzik. Did I get close?
You got it perfect.
Right on. With the California Partnership to End Domestic Violence, both co-sponsors of the bill.
Thank you. Again, we're just going to remind the witnesses to stick to the fiscal components of the measure. We don't want to rehash the policy arguments, okay? Go ahead.
Great. Good afternoon. My name is Crystal Guerrero, and I am from the Women's Policy Institute. I'm a fellow and also a co-sponsor of this bill. 1.5 million teenagers experience teen dating violence in the U.S., which costs the U.S. $5.8 billion and $4.1 billion of that is spent on healthcare services and mental health services. 1 in 10 high school students have experienced teen dating violence, including myself. And a substantial number of these occurrences happen on school campuses. Being abused makes females 6 times more likely to be pregnant and 2 times as likely to get a sexually transmitted infection, which has substantial costs to the individual, families, and the state. In a recent study, victims of adolescent relationship abuse have less education than those that don't, and research has also indicated a link between lower education attainment and lower earnings in adulthood. Adolescence is the perfect window of opportunity for prevention. This committee can play a crucial role in preventing adolescent relationship abuse. You know, healthy relationships will help our youth avoid a lifetime of negative consequences and financial impact to the state. We cannot afford to ignore vulnerable students, and we need to invest in efficient, cost-effective legislation that saves lives and protects the future of California. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for your testimony. Additional witnesses and support.
Good afternoon. Kristen Imzik with the California Partnership to End Domestic Violence. We're the co-sponsor of this bill. With regards to the specific costs to the legislation that were laid out in the analysis, and again, I want to echo my thanks to the committee staff for all of their hard work. The bill does require schools to provide education to students on healthy relationships, and we have, however, crafted the bill in such a way that it allows a great deal of flexibility to the schools in terms of how to do that. And in many communities, including in Los Angeles, where organizations like Peace Over Violence, the local domestic violence program, will actually come onto school campuses and do a lot of that work. So that flexibility that's written into the legislation does allow schools to make the smart choices that work for them and work within their budget constraints. In regards to the costs around curriculum, there are already several model curriculums that are based on a broad range of evidence throughout the nation that are available for schools to use. So again, they won't be starting over from scratch in terms of having to go through that entire process of figuring out where to start. So there are a number of items in there to help mitigate those costs. We do recognize that investing in education and requiring schools to take on these activities does come with costs. We just feel that they need to be balanced against the long-term societal costs that do impact the state's law enforcement, health, mental health, and court systems. And so we look forward to working with you as this moves to suspense.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support.
Good afternoon, Mr. Chair and members. Karen Lang on behalf of Mayor Edwin Lee and the City and County of San Francisco in support. Thank the author.
Thank you.
Good morning, Melody Crispodin on behalf of Peace Over Violence and Strong Support.
Marissa Secco with the Family Violence Law Center, also in strong support.
Thank you. Additional witnesses in support of this item. Witnesses in opposition. Finance.
No file.
No file. Comments or questions from the committee? Senator Bell.
When I was a county supervisor, we started a violence prevention program, including the teen violence program in Santa Clara County. And we noted that the Center for Disease Control has shown through their analysis that by reducing violence, significant criminal justice and health care costs are reduced. So I think it's a fiscal impact in a positive way to have prevention programs that reduce violence. And Center for Disease Control agrees. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional comments or questions from the committee? Seeing none, we will, without objection, move this bill to the suspense file. Thank you for the presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Thank you, members.
Thank you. Senator Monning is here. Senator Monning, you have one item, SB 344. It's also a candidate for suspense. Senator Monning, please come forward. The floor is yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members. Good afternoon. I know this is a candidate for suspense. I have a brief comment, if I might, present on SB 344. Members, in an effort to enhance commercial driver safety, Senate Bill 344 requires those new drivers seeking a commercial driver's license, or CDL, to complete a training course of instruction before being issued a commercial license. Under the bill, the DMV would certify that courses meet minimum standards necessary to ensure drivers are proficient in safely operating the commercial vehicle. SB 344 also removes the Bureau for Private Post-Secondary Education exemption for institutions offering certified CDL courses, thereby stopping the proliferation of what have been called diploma mills. The need for this bill became evident when a tragic truck accident on Highway 17. The truck crashed into 10 cars, injuring 7 and killing 25-year-old Daniel McGuire of Santa Cruz. The driver's lack of adequate training and experience was listed as a major factor in the crash. While I understand that this is a candidate for suspense, I'd like to note that the costs identified in the analysis are non-general fund, and both the motor vehicle account and private post-secondary education administration fund are supported by the programmatic fees. Ways to reduce costs and implementation timelines are areas that I'm willing to address should the bill come off of suspense. In addition, the federal law already recognizes the need for mandatory training for entry-level commercial vehicle drivers. And as the analysis points out, California will need to update its commercial driver license program in order to comply with these new requirements. SB 344 will prepare California's implementation on the most basic component of these regulations, and we should not take the stance of waiting on the federal government to act, especially since it's been more than 20 years since Congress's initial law to require the training. By ensuring that commercial drivers are receiving an adequate standard of training, we will reduce the risk of tragic and fatal accidents that will ultimately benefit the public and other commercial drivers. In crafting SB 344, I have and will continue to work with the trucking and commercial vehicle industries. It is worth mentioning that the California Trucking Association, representing the largest commercial truck companies, shares this priority in driver safety and supports SB 344. Thank you, Mr. Chair. We have a couple of witnesses in support.
Thank you. Witnesses in support.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, R.J. Sedamantes with the California Trucking Association here today in strong support of SB 344. We firmly believe that it's time to raise this bar and recognize the exemplary employers and folks who do it the right way, and we believe setting a minimum training standard will not only help the state but help trucking companies across California. So we appreciate the efforts of Senator Monning and urge your aye vote today.
Additional witnesses in support. Witnesses in opposition. Finance.
No file.
No file from finance. Comments or questions from committee? Senator Bell.
Well, the bad accident happened in my district, and we've reviewed this, supported in our transportation committee. I'd like to point out that from a fiscal standpoint, getting bad drivers off the road saves an immense amount of money in terms of accidents, DMV, and so forth. So this will result in getting bad drivers off the road in the trucking industry, and urge that this be considered.
Thank you, Senator Bell. Additional comments or questions from the committee?
I just have a question.
Of course.
Does this, it is on the policy, but very briefly, does it apply to out-of-state commercial drivers driving trucks into California?
Good question. It does not. If they're licensed from another state, that license is recognized in California. If they seek, even if they have out-of-state driving experience, if they seek a California license, then they would be required to show the minimum training.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Senator Bonning, without objection, we're going to move this bill to suspense. Look forward to working with you on this issue.
Likewise, thank you, and thanks to your staff. Thank you, members, and we'll look forward to this seeing further light of day. Thank you.
Thank you. We are waiting on Senator Morrell. Oh, Senator Nielsen's here. Senator Nielsen, would you like to present your SB 753? It's a candidate for suspense.
Mr. Chairman and members, this is indeed a candidate for suspense. It did pass last year. A bill was co-authored by Senator Hancock and I. This bill allows the gathering of data so we can decide whether or not realignment is working. Over decades, the failure of rehabilitation within the correctional system has been no small measure of product that we've never tracked the efficacy of the treatment, both in custody and in community. There's no question there's been an inadequacy of treatment in the community, and there still is. At the least, though, we need to find out if what we are doing is working. With this massive experiment in realignment, and that's going into the fifth year, or almost the fifth year. We really don't know whether it's successful or not, or what programs that we are utilizing in the community are successful or not. And that's what this bill will seek to do. The consultants have raised a couple of issues that I'd be happy to entertain as we work on it in suspense for amendments. They would like to have the findings and declarations removed from the codification section. I think they make sense where they're at, but I'd be willing to entertain that consideration. And that we utilize federal funds, but not to supplant or substitute. I'd like to make that very clear, that they would be utilized as enhancements, not as to supplant state funding. Realignment is a state imposition on counties. It is not a federal one. So the state obviously has a legitimate responsibility. And I'm willing to consider something about the dates. It makes mention that there's difficulty for the counties to try to implement it. And it indicates that requiring to report before January 2016 would be less than 6 months after the initial report to the legislature required. I would not be willing to go much beyond June 2016, but we can discuss that. And the reason being, we're going to be 5 years into this experiment, and we don't know what's going on out there. And I don't think we should prolong it, but I'm willing to entertain some kind of a amendment related to that reporting date. Data is a key driver, and everybody has recognized that there is this need. In fact, your committee analysis is very thorough about it, referencing the Public Policy Institute of California, who have testified here in the legislature before. It in part notes no incentives, resources, or standards for counties to measure outcomes. And we have 58 different counties participating variously and under different circumstances in this experiment. And there's no consistency in the data that they're bringing forward. And particularly egregious omission is we have no data about completion of a program. Placing someone in AA or anger management is pretty meaningless unless we have that individual tracked and that individual completes the rehabilitation. So that argues to the need for this bill. The Bureau of State Audit says the current state does not have access to reliable, meaningful data to monitor. Those are the arguments in favor of. So this is an opportunity for us to ensure that realignment works. And where it needs some fine-tuning and some changes, that we may be able to ascertain where those places are and what they may be. I believe that this is a very good candidate to bring off of suspense because everyone has acknowledged the critical need for this data. I'd be happy to work committee on suspense towards these points that I've raised.
Thank you, Senator Nielsen. Witnesses in support of the measure. Witnesses in opposition. Finance.
No file.
No file from finance. They must be busy doing something. I can help on a couple items if you want. Comments and question from committee. Thank you, Senator Nielsen.
We'll work with you on suspense. Thank you.
Without objection, we'll move this issue to suspense.